Last week, CD Projekt Red released Update 2.0 for Cyberpunk 2077. This new update serves as an overhaul of the whole game, introducing new mechanics and major gameplay improvements. And alongside Update 2.0, CDPR also released the first and probably the last expansion for the game, Phantom Liberty, which introduces a new city district called Dogtown. And in terms of visuals, it's evident that this expansion had made some noticeable improvements, particularly when it comes to the geometric complexity. Each area in Dogtown is packed with ton of geometry and details, which significantly enrich the game's environments and makes Dogtown more captivating to explore. And in today's video, we will revisit the game's graphic settings and this new area and compare the visual and performance impact of each one. So without any further ado, let's get started. Now let's kick off with a quick comparison between version 1.63 and 2.0. In terms of GPU performance, we can see that there is no significant difference between the previous version and the new one. However, when it comes to the CPU performance, it's a whole different story. Update 2.0 is more CPU intensive, and here we can see that the previous version runs around 25% better compared to the current version. And I suspect that the new Police AI system that was introduced with Update 2.0, alongside many improvements to the NPC reactions, could be the reason behind this difference in CPU performance. Speaking of CPU performance, this new update introduced a new setting under gameplay called AMD Simultaneous Multi-Threading, or SMT, which makes the game utilize all available cores and threads when running on an AMD CPU. And here with the Ryzen 5 5600X, we can see that enabling SMT improves the performance by around 12% when CPU limited. So make sure this setting is on if you have an AMD CPU that supports SMT. Now let's move on to image quality, and here nothing really changed compared to the previous versions. DLAA still has a ton of ghosts in, and using DLAA can clear this problem and provide much cleaner image at native resolution. And performance wise, enabling DLAA can cost around 8%. However, for some reasons, when using ultra or psycho screen space reflections, enabling DLAA can cost up to 48%, which is insane. Therefore, if you want to enable DLAA, I recommend using high or lower options for screen space reflections. When it comes to upscaling, the game now supports XeSS. And here when comparing the standard DP4A model to FSR2, we can see that XeSS looks much stable and has less shimmering compared to FSR2. However, both XeSS and DLSS have issues when it comes to handling rainy weather. Here we can see that DLSS failed to reconstruct objects behind the raindrops, exposing the raw pixels of the game. And XeSS smears the raindrops, which makes the rain looks inaccurate, unlike FSR2. Now when it comes to which one you should choose, I think if you have an RTX GPU, DLSS is the obvious choice. And if not, XeSS can overall deliver better image quality compared to FSR2. But keep in mind that this is the standard DP4A model, and it's unlikely to provide a similar level of performance as FSR2. This new update introduced a new DLSS feature called Ray Reconstruction, which is an AI-driven model designed to replace all manually on denoisers for various ray tracing effects. The idea behind this is to prevent any degradation in quality that typically occurs when using ray tracing with DLSS upscaling. And according to Nvidia, it can even surpass the quality of native denoisers. DLSS Ray Reconstruction works with all RTX GPUs. However, as for now, it's exclusively compatible with path tracing when DLSS is in use. And there is currently no official support for ray reconstruction when using regular ray tracing effects or DLAA. And here I am running path tracing at 1440p with performance DLSS. And we can see that at this low resolution, reflections look better and more stable with ray reconstruction. And similar thing here with the foliage. And there are numerous instances in which ray reconstruction improves the quality and preserves more details. However, it's still early days for this technology, and of course it's not perfect. Ray reconstruction exhibits noticeable smearing and ghosting artifacts around some elements, like here with the distant NPCs, and it can also change the appearance of character faces. But as I said, it's still early days, and future iterations of this technology will address these limitations. And performance-wise, I measured around 6% improvement alongside reduced VRAM usage when using ray reconstruction. Now let's talk about some settings that still don't have any significant impact on both visuals and performance. First, we have improved facial lighting geometry. And as you can see here, both options look and perform similarly. And similar thing with subsurface scattering quality, which should enhance the quality of lighting on some surfaces like character skin, but there is no substantial visual or performance difference between low and high. Next we have color precision. This one doesn't impact the visuals, but using high costs around 2%, so medium is the best option here. Max dynamic decals is another one. You will rarely see the effect of this setting during normal gameplay, as you will have to unload a weapon extensively in a small area to notice the impact of this setting. And both low and ultra have similar performance, so keep this one at ultra. And the last setting here is level of detail or LOD, which still doesn't do anything. As you can see here, this house alternates between its low and high geometric LOD at the same distance when using low and high. And performance wise, there is no significant difference. And it's quite disappointing because the LOD in this game is so bad. Driving or just running around shows a lot of LOD pop in, which negatively impact the game's presentation. And I was hoping that update 2.0 will address this problem, but unfortunately that did not happen. And with that out of the way, let's take a look at the remaining graphic settings, starting with textures. And VRAM wise, the game is still perfectly playable with 8GB GPUs at native 1440p, and I think even 6GB will be enough for this resolution. However, textures are not the only factor that can impact the VRAM usage, and we'll talk about that later in this video. Next we have depth of field, and this one is more noticeable during conversations and cutscenes, and it doesn't have a big impact on performance, so if you like this effect, don't worry and keep it on. Contact shadows allows some objects to cast shadows, which can help ground these objects and give more depth to the scene, and performance wise this setting has negligible impact, so keep it on. Anisotropy controls texture filtering, and using higher samples make textures look cleaner when viewed at an oblique angle. And as usual, this setting doesn't have any significant performance impact, so here I recommend 16. Next we have local shadow mesh quality. This one controls the geometric quality used to cast sun shadows, and not only local shadows. As you can see here, with medium and high we get more geometry in these shadows unlike low, and this setting has no significant performance costs, so here I recommend high. The next shadow setting is local shadow quality. This one controls the resolution and quality of artificial light shadows, and performance wise going from off to medium doesn't have any significant impact, but going to high costs around 5%. So for this one, if you need more performance, use medium and don't turn off local shadows, as doing so will significantly impact the visuals without any performance gain. Next we have cascaded shadow range. This one controls the draw distance of sun shadows, and using higher options enable more shadows for distance objects and NPCs, and low and medium perform similarly, but going to high costs around 3%, so here I recommend medium. Cascaded shadows resolution controls the sharpness and quality of sun shadows, and performance wise there is a noticeable impact only when going to high shadows, so here I recommend avoiding low and go for medium or high cascaded shadows. Distance shadows resolution is similar to the previous setting, but for shadows far away from the camera, and here going from low to high doesn't have any performance impact, so for this one I recommend high. Volumetric fog resolution controls the quality of volumetric lighting and effects, and it's more noticeable on moving volumetric lights like here, and performance wise in a scene with a lot of volumetrics we can see that going from low to medium doesn't have any impact, but going to high costs around 8% and to ultra 10%, so here for my optimized settings I recommend medium. Volumetric cloud quality, as the name suggests, should control the resolution and quality of volumetric clouds, but similar to the previous version, there is no visual difference between medium, high and ultra, despite the fact that using ultra can cost an additional 8% and going from off to medium and high costs 8%. But during normal gameplay where you are not looking directly on the sky, the performance impact is much smaller. So here for this one I recommend at least medium. Screen space reflections quality is still one of the most demanding settings in this game. Here going from off to low costs around 6% to medium 10%, High 16%, Ultra 22%, and finally to Cycle 54%. And here turning off reflections will negatively impact the visuals, given that the game is filled with reflective surfaces everywhere. That's why I recommend at least medium SSR, and if you have enough performance to spare, use high. Ambient Occlusion adds soft shadows to objects that are in close proximity to one another. And as I always say, this is an essential setting, and turning it off can negatively impact the game's visuals. And performance wise, going from off to low costs around 6%, to medium 9%, and to high 12%. So for this one, I recommend at least low or medium, and don't turn off ambient occlusion. Next, we have mirror quality, and this one controls the resolution of mirror reflections. And performance wise, going from low to medium costs 12%, and to high 28%. Now, mirrors don't have reflections unless you interact with them, and during these moments, there isn't a lot of gameplay involved. That's why I recommend high mirror quality. And the last non-ray tracing setting is crowd density, which adjusts the quantity of NPCs in densely populated areas like here. And this setting mainly affects CPU performance. As you can see here, when CPU limited, going from low to medium costs 7% and to high 14%. So given that the game now is more CPU intensive, first try medium, and if you are still having FPS drops and low GPU usage, use low crowd density. Now let's move on to ray tracing, starting with ray trace reflections, which significantly enhance reflections when compared to Ultra or Psycho SSR. And performance wise, enabling RT reflections from Ultra SSR costs around 36%, but it also significantly increased the VRAM usage and the allocated VRAM. Next, we have ray trace sun shadows, which enhance shadows from the sun, as you can see here. And performance wise, enabling this effect can cost around 22%. Ray trace local shadows is similar to the previous setting, but for artificial light shadows. And performance wise, it costs around 16%. Ray trace lighting, when enabled, provides more accurate global illumination and ambient occlusion. And this is the most intensive regular ray tracing effect, as going from off to medium costs around 37%, to high 14%, and to Psycho 45%. Now, if you want to use any regular RT effect, I recommend RT reflections, as this has the biggest impact on the visuals. RT shadows are so hard to notice, and RT lighting looks great, but it comes with a big cost and it doesn't have the same impact on the visuals as RT reflections. And finally, we have patch tracing. This is a full ray tracing mod that replaces every aspect of the game's rendering with physically accurate lighting, shadows, reflections, and more. And of course, it's so intensive, and only the most powerful GPUs out there can handle this mod with playable performance. Now, based on everything we saw so far, these are my recommended settings. Let's now quickly compare optimized settings on Ultra preset. And here I am running the game at native 1440p without DLAA or ray tracing on both sides. And we can see that on average, optimized settings boost performance by around 48%, with minimal impact on the visual quality. And with that, we reach the conclusion of this video. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.